Okay, so this is week four actually, and we're doing lab three. We'll be doing pipe cutting and threading. And what kind of pipes are we talking about? It's the galvanized steel pipes. They are galvanized because they are sealed and insulated, and they're made out of steel. So we'll talk about piping, and it will be only one lab. We can do a lot of HVAC related plumbing, and you're not allowed to do a lot of plumbing in the house unless you're certified. However, if you have a small pipe vent or a condition, they'll come in handy too to connect your own boiler. If you're working with steam, probably you'll do some sort of plumbing to connect the radiators to your boiler. So it's not a lot, but we will learn how to do threading, how to take measurement, and how do we actually do safe and proper cutting and threading for galvanized steel pipes. So what is plumbing? Where do you think plumbing work came from?
Probably Greek or something.
Good. We're getting closer.
Romans?
Yeah. Huh? It is Greek. And where does it come from?
Aqueducts.
No. So plum is the symbol in the periodic table as the PV. Plumb. That's for what type of material?
Copper?
Lead. No.
Lead.
Lead. So that's lead. Because the first pipes were made out of lead.
Oh. Scary.
And actually, a lot of cities have lead pipes in them.
Still?
Yeah. There's only three cities in the US, actually two cities in the US that have completely plumb-free piping for water, just so you know. And we all heard about the plumbing issue, the lead poisoning in Flint, Michigan.
Is that still going on?
Yeah, still going on.
Shouldn't they have fixed that already? That's like ridiculous.
You know how expensive it is to change piping that's been there for 150 years? Well, it's a budgetary thing. And you know all pipe leaks? You know how much we lose out of water coming from the municipality to your house as a percentage? On average, in every city? 30% is lost to the ground.
Wait, so are we still paying for that 30% though? That's lost?
Probably no, you pay the meter at your house.
Oh, okay.
But that's losses of water. And also if water coming out, what else is coming in? You have cracks, you have leaks. So any contamination is gonna come into your pipe, into your water supply. So you always gotta be careful. If you buy it, a used house, and you're in doubt, you can bring somebody to come and test the water for drinking, otherwise we'll drink the water. Even if it's small percentage of contamination, if you're going to be eating and drinking that water for like a few years, probably it's not a good idea. And that's why a lot of cities have voted against hydrofracking, for fracking, which basically it's a way to get a lot of gas from the ground. And they don't want that because it might damage the aquifer where they get the water from. But anyways, this is the basis of plumbing. We used plumbing at the beginning to make pipes, and it was very soft material, easy to make pipes. And how do we make a pipe? If you were like stranded in a desert in an island, and you want to make a pipe, how would you go about doing that?
I'll coconut tree.
So you can hollow a tree, hollow a pipe, trunk, huh?
A bamboo tree.
Can use bamboo trees. Actually, it has been used, and people also use clay. During the Roman time, they had clay pipes made out of clay. Till this day, yeah, we use cement pipes, big size pipes made out of cement. So for if you want to do a small metallic pipe, either you get a strip metal and you spiral around. If you look a lot of the duct venting, that's a spiral vent. They have a strip that goes all around in a spiral that makes a pipe. But again, that's if you are going to make it for water or for liquid, you have to seal it very, very well. Or you can make one big strip of pipe and move it around. I'll illustrate that a little bit. So either you get up and then you spiral it. Until you end up with a pipe. So you twist it around, or you get one piece of rectangular metal and you fold it. You roll it and you make a pipe. So it makes sense to make the pipe out of soft material because you're going to do all this kind of work. So that's why they started out with the lead piping. So they're made out of steel, zinc, and sometimes carbon steel. And that's why they are darker color. They carbon steel resist rust. That's one of the properties of carbon steel. It's stronger, it resists rust, and it has a lot of dexterity, so it will last without being bent. So it does not resist, it does not bend very easily. So a lot of the issues we have with piping, one of them is corrosion. What is the difference between corrosion and erosion?
Corrosion is a buildup of stuff. Erosion is degrading or something.
Both. That's a good definition, actually.
Isn't corrosion like rusting or something?
Yeah. And erosion? So we both, in both situations, we're losing material, right?
Yes.
But one of them is...
Isn't erosion more natural?
Yeah.
They don't can be natural. When you erode your beaches or your rocks, that's natural. So corrosion, guys, corrosion is chemical. It's a chemical reaction. Erosion is mechanical. So when your rocks in the at the beach get hit by the waves, you have sand and they can sand it down, that's erosion. When your pipe turns from steel to iron oxide, that's corrosion. That's when you have rust. So that's the difference. One of them is corrosion, it's chemical, and the other one is mechanical. And they both happen in our pipes. Over time, if they're not very, if it's old, and they get some nicks in it. Again, remember, it's galvanized. If you scratch it, this is a way where it will rust, and it will have a buildup, and that will, you'll lose the material. So when you have rust, you lost some of the material you have to start with. So that is corrosion. Erosion is when you have water with particles in it and it keep chiseling at the material and taking some of it with it. So for example, your car engine has a lot of erosion over time. That's why you keep changing the oil filter. You see small, dusty metal in it, particles. That's part of your engine. Over time, it will keep taking small pieces of it. With the oil. We also have buildups. What are the buildups? That have nothing to do with the material. That's other material accumulating on the pipe. Sand, dust, other rust from other pipes,
dirt,
calcium, anything can accumulate over time and do and clog our pipes. Again, another issue is expansion and contraction. So pipes are steel. And we say that metals, when you heat them, what happens to them? They expand, and then they contract. If you look at the piping from the steel pipe over there, you don't see any fixed holders. They're all flexible. They give you at least like 1 foot or 2 feet of moving space. In the winter, when they heat it up with steel, they will expand. So when you give it room to expand, otherwise what will happen?
Correct.
Crack. So you have to accommodate for the expansion and contraction of these pipes with the amount of steel. So that's another issue. And when things expand and contract a lot, over time, what will happen? They will fatigue. They will break. So if you go and see some kind of very, very long pipelines, like oil lines from east to west, or like cross country, you will see pipe going straight, and you see a loop. Going a few miles, and then a few miles, a few yards, a couple hundred yards, you find another loop. These loops help with the expansion of pipes. And in the summertime, you'll see these loops look like this. Summertime. In the winter, they will contract. So remember this when you go through the oil burner exam, and they ask you why do we always use swivel joints. We do not use, if you have two tanks, you do not connect those two tanks with one rigid pipe for the same reason. That's why we use a swivel joint. We actually use something similar to that. We put an elbow, another pipe, an elbow, and so on and so forth. So that will accommodate for the small expansion and contraction. You might not see it, but in a long pipe, it's very visible. If you remember, if you look in the hallway, look up at the pipes and see how much it moves. And that's why you never have any loose, you don't have any rigid fittings. And what else? What about if you put that pipe through a wall? Do you want to like cement that wall and seal it? No. Always count on the pipes expanding and contracting. And iron is very, very malleable material, which means it will expand and contract a lot. So what do we need to know about the pipe information and the material it's made of? Why do we need to know that? Because we need to know what's going to run through it, right? We want the least reaction. That's why we do not use any galvanized steel pipes with oil, because that will react with the chemicals that insulate the pipes. What do you use with oil? No plastic. No. No.
Copper
is the least reactive pipes. Use copper for drinking water, use copper for refrigerant, use copper for oil. You never use galvanized steel, unless it's coated, special coated ones. You need to know the ID and OD and T. Right off the bat, what do you think OD, ID is?
Inside diameter. There's something called nominal diameter. What is the nominal? It took me a while to understand what is nominal. I just took it, the nominal for this and the nominal for that. What is the nominal? It's what it's known for. It's the easy way to remember. It's what it's known for. So sometimes you buy a quarter inch nominal diameter and you go measure the outside, it's not quarter inch. You go measure the inside, it's not quarter inch. It just known as. Also, it's like the universally known.
Yeah.
Like a 2x4 is not really a.
I was about to say that. Which confused the heck out of me when I was at Home Depot. I want 2x4. I went there with a measuring tape. Like, what's a 2x4? It's not actually 2x4. You just call 2x4, but it's not 2x4. And they. Actually, you know why is it not 2x4? Somebody told me that before. That when they freshly cut it, it's 2x4. As it dries, it shrinks. I'm not even sure.
I'm not sure.
Yeah?
Okay.
What is T again? Thickness.
Thickness from the inside to the outside of the pipe?
Elbows, we know elbows, 90, 45, 180, return, so it's a turn off the U. T's and caps, and those are important for flow. Which one has the most resistance to the flow?
180.
Yeah, taking a whole turn, so you can lose a lot of flow. So 45 is the most favorite one because it has the least turn. The more you turn the fluid, the more momentum you use, and the more forces you will encounter. But we're not going to think about that a lot. We'll do what we can. At least number of elbows you use, the better. Connections and reducers. So connectors usually connect two pipes together, and reducers change the diameter of the pipe from like 2 inches to 1 inch. And what happens when you change the area? You increase the pressure. You expand the area, you decrease the pressure. Flanges are used to connect two pipes together. A flange looks like an orifice, a pipe going through it, and it has holes. So you get another one over there, you put a gasket between them, and you press them together. You'll see that a lot in power plant. If you took the power plant course, if you're taking it right now, probably you'll encounter flanges, and they're important for high pressure, and they have good connections. And they get bigger. As the pipe gets bigger, you're gonna do your circular connections. Just think about it. If you're gonna connect it with a thread, how are you gonna connect like 4 inches of pipe together? That's really difficult. Best practice when you're trying to install pipes, it's use a water level to ensure the pitch. Next semester, when we do steam, you understand if you have the wrong pitch, you'll have a lot of problems, and you'll have what's called the water hammering. If you ever had steam, you just turn on the system, there's water, and the pipe is not pitched correctly, so it will encounter steam, and that's when you have a water hammering, and somebody, it sounds like somebody's banging with a hammer in your pipes. So you don't want that. Before you cut pipe, put a plan layout. What do I need? The measurement, and get the right type of connections and the right type of solution. Using PVC, for example, you have the right compound, and sometimes you need some tape if you're using water. So make sure you have the right tape. Do we use Teflon with oil?
No.
Pipes? No, never. There are tapes that are. Have the specification for oil. Pressure and the water weight inside the pipe, that's something you have to account for. Why?
For the hanger,
for the support. Otherwise, it's going to be heavier and it will bend and break. Or maybe have the wrong pitch. If you were to install a boiler, which I hope one day you'll do that, you'll need to know about the piping, especially. I don't think anybody installed new steam. If you are to replace a new boiler for a steam system, you'll do some connections, and you should be aware of the pitch. What is the pitch requirement? What is the flow? What kind of tile? What kind of temperature? So you can select the correct pipes. If you put PVC, it might work for a few days, then it will start changing properties, and eventually it will crack. So what is the diameter? It's double the radius. So if you see a radius, that's half diameter. So if this is the diameter, in this point here, that's the radius. Just to be on the same page for terminology. Ductility, elongation, and deformation. Some things you will hear about, I don't want you to know all of them, but what is ductility? When something is ductile, what if something is brittle? What does that mean?
Fragile,
breaks. So ductility is the opposite of realness.
So it's
tough, strong.
It's not really about strong. It can be strong and brittle. Like ceramic is very strong, but it's very brittle. Metals are very strong, but they're ductile, they bend with you. So if they're bendable, they're ductile. Elongation, they do elongate. Again, you can elongate it.
You can deform them.
Yeah, and they can be deformed. Can you deform ceramic? No. It won't allow you to deform it, it will just break. So it's very strong, but it's not susceptible to elongation and deformation. We talked about erosion and corrosion. So what do we need? Why do we need plumbing and HVAC? Heating pipes and radiators. For radiators, you will use either PEX, which is the new connections now, and eventually you will do some copper. And you can do press connections. And if you are to connect oil lines, you will use flare fittings. You don't use threads with copper. We'll do that next week. For water supply is always pipes connection. So you always have to find a supply line for your boiler. So you'll need to do some plumbing, but not a lot, probably a few connections. Steam always requires some plumbing work. And probably if you're going to do plumbing for the entire steam house, you will have to partner up with a certified plumber. It takes 5,000 hours of work to become a certified plumber. Drainage and more, if you're going to have a drain for your water, you need this kind of plumbing. And knowing how to cut a thread will make your life much easier. Threads, inside and out. So if you buy a fitting, probably the thread is in the inside or outside?
Inside.
Inside. So mostly you will do threading on the outside only. If you do threads from the inside, what is that called? Tapping. We're not doing tapping now. We're doing only threading from the outside. The inside will buy with the connections. Most fittings are pre-threaded, and the threading is universal. Pipe size, I will show you that chart. What is the pitch? What do you mean by the pitch?
The angle it rises at.
Yeah. And that angle is very, very important. And it's really carefully calculated. Because if it's too high, it will slip. If it's too low, it will not hold. So you need to know the right pitch for the pipes. So these are the most common standardized pipe threads, the American standards and the British standards, and they go with the nominal OD, and it's the cut which the pipe is known for, threads per inch, how many threads, that's the number of threads, and this is for the pitch, for the standard radius, so this is just for information. This is another chart that shows you what is the pitch and how many threads do you do for a quarter, for the pipe. It's how much you need to get the portion of the pipe that you need to get threaded so you don't go overboard and thread the entire pipe. How much do you need? If you have a 1 inch, probably you go with the same 1 inch length of threads and so on and so forth. So don't go overboard with that. So for a 1 inch pipe, you get like 32 millimeter, which is 3 centimeters, almost a little bit over an inch. So use the chart if you have to. But for as a general rule, we use the same length of the pipe. It's 2 inches or 2 inches of thread.
Why would they use inches and then go here?
Huh?
Why would they use inches and then go
here? I don't know, it's confusing. That's like a mixed up. Yeah, 1 inch. Because most pipes, even internationally, they're known by inches. Wherever you go, they say 1 inch pipe. And even though they use metric, everybody uses inches for pipes, from what I know so far. So this is our pipe fitting area. This is our old pipe threader. Feel free to use it if you want to, just so you can get in touch with the test. But it's unsafe because it's powered and doesn't have a foot pedal. And the reverse button is very confusing. We have three devices for pipes over here. We have a lot of fittings and some pipes. So we'll try to experiment with those. And again, I got a new pipe threader. It's the Rigid Compact 300. And hopefully, if you work for an HVAC company, they have a new day. You want you to do a lot of pipe fitting. You have a power one. If it's one or two joints, that's fine. It'll be okay if you use it by hand. But trust me, after three threads, your hand will be sore. That's why probably plumbers are very muscular. They do it by hand. But I don't think anybody does it by hand. And you'll see it's very fatiguing. This is the new pipe threader. So basically it does everything. So you think the machine will turn on the thread or turn on the pipe? Turn around the pipe.
Turn on the pipe.
It will turn the pipe. You're doing the opposite when you're doing it by hand. You hold the pipe in place and you turn the tool by hand. This machine will turn it completely. You hold the pipe inside, put a grip on it, and it will turn the pipe, and you apply whatever you want. You want to cut it, you want to thread it. What is an important part of threading? Of course, you need the alignment, you need the size, lubrication,
oil,
keep lubrication, and also you want to remove the chips as you actually chipping off from the pipe. So if you don't remove it, they get stuck. Especially if you're doing it by hand, you want to move a quarter turn. Move a half a turn, then you go back to quarter. Lubricate and move the chips, and then go back again. Otherwise, the chips will get trapped into your bed and it becomes very tough to move. Have a video here that we'll watch at the end of the class. So you need a thread pit, a bit, which is actually a big tool. The handle has a pit, and every pipe has its own bit. So that's why we have three or four for the pipes we have. And we need a bit holder. So you have only one holder. If you buy a hand pipe thinner, it comes with a case, has all the bits in it in one hand. It's kind of like using a wrench. You just change the bits. You need a grip vise, you need some thick gloves. If you don't have thick gloves, you can borrow some from the shop. But please don't work without gloves, because again, now we're working with sharp metals. And and it's easier to have a grip on the pipes and the tools with a good glove. Otherwise, you get oily and messy, and probably it will slip from your hand, and you're just unsafe. We'll have three in a group, so three will work together. And it helps if somebody's watching and somebody's like doing the cut. But everybody has to do a cut and a thread. It turns doing that. And well, goggles are important. These do not work without goggles, and long sleeves are important. Be aware if you use the pipe threader. I think the new one is safe, but the other one, the old one, sometimes you let go of the tool and it will just spring on you. I will not deal with that anymore. So if you need lab coats, they're available at the bookstore, or otherwise just wear a long, thick shirt. And you'll be surprised how a shirt can protect sometimes. Even for a slipping pipe, it will protect you a little bit. I have a video about how pipes are made, but I want to watch the video. The link over here. So I'll stop the video right now, but you can watch this video later on.